morning, everybody. Welcome to the Thursday seminar series, and this is the third in succession. Thank you very much for making it successful. Today's speaker is Dr. Anil Kumar. He will be speaking to us on revisiting botanic garden narratives, research and action, a case study of M.S. Swaminathan Botanical Garden at Wayanad. This talk will outline the conservation, biodiversity conservation narratives, primarily action and research, citing the case of Swaminathan Botanical Garden established to maintain conservation narrative of wild plant biodiversity amidst climate change mitigation and in food and nutrition concerns. There is a large body of literature available on conservation, and this is one such view how the botanic gardens can enhance conservation value. And we have seen how botanic gardens will have a higher value in other countries, and perhaps Dr. Anil Kumar will let us know on the experiences from the other examples as well outside the world. We have many other examples, like what I did mostly in the last 20 or years or so, making communities conserve forests, particularly in their own forest lands, and the forest conservation by various initiatives, particularly in India in 1974's Forest Conservation Act, which has been quite successful, as people claim. And there are many other efforts. I don't have to go about it. So Dr. Anil Kumar will be flowing through those ideas to some extent on these things, I guess. And I will let him talk about it. And we all know Dr. Anil Kumar, who also served here as executive director last year. And he has lots of experience in conservation, biodiversity conservation particularly. He is currently senior director at Wayanad Center, our MSSRF Wayanad Center, and he started working in MSSRF since 1992, almost 28 years now. That's when I completed my PhD, so it's quite a while now. He has over 10 years experience as director of MSSRF's Community Agrobiodiversity Center and over 70 research publications. And of course, he has also written lots of articles in magazines, popular magazines and so on. And he has come up with lots of rich experience both in conservation with the people and in the community. So I will let Anil speak to you without much ado. Over to you, Anil. Thank you so much for agreeing today.
Thank you, Dr. Murali, for a very elaborate introduction. And thank you for those kind words about me. So also, I would like to thank Ms. Jayashree for offering this opportunity, in the sense, though I was not prepared to give a talk on a kind of short notice. But since botanical garden and biodiversity is very close to my heart, I thought of giving this talk. So I might take some 40 minutes to speak. I don't know how much time we have for this seminar. But I will be going through the purpose of botanic gardens, the kind of, I will be also introducing you a kind of biodiversity revisited approach. So I have titled my talk in this way, Revisiting Botanic Garden Narratives, Research and Action. So the narratives on research and also the narratives itself under the narratives on action. And I will try to give the example of this botanical garden where I sit now. It's a small botanical garden. My presentation I have divided into three parts. The part one, where you know this concept is introduced, and part two, the case study, and part three, the MSSBG way forward, the ideas and plan. If you look at the part one, the biodiversity revisited. If you look at the biodiversity revisited agenda, before that, you know, you have to see why this revisit is needed. If you look at every 20 minutes in this world, you know, some 3,500 human lives being added. But on the contrary, you can see every 60 minutes, some 240 acres of natural forest being destroyed. And every 40 minutes, we lose many species every 40 minutes. So the if you look at the IPBS, the Intergovernmental Science Policy Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services, their estimate is about 1 million species are threatened with extinction. And this extinction of species beyond the threshold leads to the collapse of ecosystem. So we are actually in a very, very precarious situation. So if you look at the definition of the biodiversity conservation, this word is coined in somewhere in the 1980s, and it's more a scientific concept. If you look at the CBD defines the Biodiversity Conservation Institute as conservation of ecosystems and natural habitats, and the maintenance and recovery of viable populations of species in their natural surroundings, and in the case of domesticated or cultivated species, in the surroundings where they have developed their distinct properties. So when you say conservation of when you say conservation of biodiversity, you are either referring to in situ conservation or you are referring to the on-farm conservation. But this definition, and also many of the other definitions, none of those definitions actually address measures and policies to conserve biodiversity. So this is where, you know, the kind of really we have to look into what is wrong with the biodiversity conservation. If you see, there is now a wealth of research that acknowledges the biodiversity cannot be fully understood in isolation of the human societies that live alongside it, have shaped it, and are shaped by it. And this extends beyond questions of conservation. So if you see, for example, the focus on species specific aspects of biodiversity, the biophysical or, you know, the typical, the ecosystem, the kind of ecological science approach, they focus on species, habitats, ecosystem traits, and so on. But whereas, you know, if you look at the social science research, they primarily falls into two arenas. Research for conservation, that provides insights into the social, political, and economic processes that could enhance the biodiversity conservation goals. And the research on conservation, when I say the research on conservation, the studies that investigate the conservation movement as a social phenomenon. So when you look at this, the biodiversity revisited approach, you can see there the overarching goal is actually sustaining diverse and just futures for life on Earth. When we say the biodiversity revisited approach, this particular goal has got the knowledge creation, where, you know, the multidisciplinary knowledges are created, and these knowledges collected on the actions, and the actions contribute to the knowledge as well as, and these actions contribute to the ethical dimension or the ethical value, and this value system that we draw upon to do so is our ethics, and this ethics connected to the knowledge. What I'm pointing here is the biodiversity, when we say the conservation, all these three elements are very important. And these knowledges actually created based on 9 principles. These principles, if you look at, these principles are in generic kind of principles. If you look at the pluralistic view, for example, if you look at pluralistic view, explicitly recognize that there are multiple ways of knowing and there are multiple ways of doing and valuing life on earth. Pluralism emphasizes the benefit that comes from this diversity of thought rather than forcing consensus or privileging dominant approaches. And it leads to the reflexive principle, the humbleness, the innovativeness, the accountability, the pragmatism, you know, all these principles contribute to our knowledge creation. And this knowledge, this sort of a knowledge, not a kind of, you know, very, very partial or a very, only a very particular system specific knowledge. For example, we scientists, you know, we normally look into the ecology specific knowledge, or the social scientists look into only the social system specific knowledge. So from that compartmental isolation, how we can, you know, integrate the knowledge. For example, if you look at the biodiversity narratives, there are basically 2 kinds of narratives. One is the ecocentric narrative, where, you know, the ecologists say 50% of this earth should be, we have to demarcate 50% of the earth for the biodiversity. And we have another very, very strong view, the anthropocentric approach, where, you know, the biodiversity is actually part of the human dominant realm, and the biodiversity, the culture is part of the biodiversity. And there is another system of thought, the nature is for nature and ecosystem services is for the economic development. So how do we take into consideration of all these three views for enabling biodiversity, transformative research and change? So we should take into consideration of the ecosystem, ecocentric approach, the anthropocentric approach, the kind of, you know, the economy-centric approach, where the biodiversity should be utilized for the benefits of the community. So within this framework, I am trying to put the MSSBG case study. If you look at a botanical garden, the Botanical Garden Conservation International, they have defined this, the garden is a place where having a reasonable degree of permanence, an underlying scientific basis for the collections, proper documentation of the collections, including wild origin, and proper monitoring of the plants in the collections, adequate labeling of the plants, and such kind of a place should be open to the public, and such kind of a place should be communication of information to other gardens, in other gardens, institutions, and the public, and so on. And also this garden should exchange seeds and other planting materials to other botanical garden. If you look at these parameters, except that bolded one, all other parameters, in fact, the MSSBG qualifies for a typical botanical garden characteristics. If you see the history of the botanical garden, the oldest still existing garden, in fact, from the 16th century. But you have reference from the 4th century garden. If you take, for example, Theophrastus, the father of botany, which we call, so there in the Athens, the Lyceum garden, where, you know, the even the Alexander the Great, or the collections, in fact, Alexander the Great's collections from all over the world, he used to give it to the Lyceum in Athens. So you can see the garden history right from the 4th century at least. And coming to the 21st century garden, the present garden, this century of gardens actually focus on the conservation of biodiversity and the science of conservation and science of climate change and also the garden for the social relevance. So but if you look at the previous century, particularly the 17th to 20th century garden, is mostly for the aesthetic purpose, you know, mostly for recreation. But that dimension is slowly changing. Now the botanical garden is getting into more socially relevant research and socially relevant action. So the MSSBG, in fact, if you look at the history, the Swaminathan and Mrs. Swaminathan, they had donated some 5 hectares of land, exactly 13.5 acres of land to MSSRF to start a community agrobiodiversity center. And this garden, we have established in 2010. In fact, you know, in this land donated by Professor Swaminathan. And the garden establishment, when I say, the center started its work in 1997. So from the collections from that period onwards, from 1997 onwards, so around 10, 13 years of collections, we assembled and formed into a botanical garden. Now we have expanded our land area from 13 acres. We are now in the possession of 41 acres of land. And out of these 41 acres of land, we are planning to have some 20 acres, 50% of the land area into a garden. And you can see the components there. We have divided several components, but we don't have all the components now active there. But you have elements there. For example, the aquatic zone, the bamboo garden, aquarium, climbing plants, so on and so on. And this is the entrance. You can see the main entrance there. And when it blooms, now we see particularly my focus completely on the kind of, you know, developing this garden into a full-fledged garden. And we are now actually trying to promote this garden as a community garden. When I say a community garden, there will be satellite gardens. So already there are some 7 pilot gardens. So our idea is to have some 100 satellite garden. When I say a satellite community garden, each garden will have 1 acre. Each farmer or a planter will donate 1 acre, and the seed materials, planting materials, which we give it to them. And the central garden, our MSSBG, will have 20 acres plus these 100 acres of the farmer gardens. Within next 5 years, we are trying to have such kind of a full-fledged garden. And this is the present view, the butterfly garden, you can see there. And if you look at, we have some more than 60 or 80 different species which can attract butterflies, the plant species. And we recorded from this garden more than 100 and 110 species of butterflies visiting this garden. And we have a wild food zone here. There, you know, when I say a community garden, the center made a study of the wild food of Wayanad district, and the study revealed some 300 species of wild food plants, in which more than 80 species are edible green species, and there are several wild yams and so on. So this garden, if you look at, we have a garden to showcase the culinary and the curative diversity. The culinary diversity, when I say the edible plants and the the wild food plants. And we also, the garden is, we have strong presence of the RET species. So the RET species, particularly the RET tree species, it is a combined botanical garden, a combined facility for ex situ and on-farm conservation. And the total number, you can see there, we have trees, some 250 number of tree species, some 500 species of medicinal plants, you can see. Altogether, we have over 1,000 plant species now. Some point of time, when I remember when I was here, the total number of species went up to 1,800 species. So now we have, so some of the species we have lost for various reasons. And on the left side, those are some of the very critically endangered tree species which are grown in the this garden. And this some of the pictures of the garden, the tree species from the garden. All these species are IUCN red listed category species. And if you look at the saving trees and saving lives, I would say, so we have our scientists have located many such endangered species all over the southern Western Ghats. We had a team of research scholars. In fact, this project started when Professor Swaminathan celebrated his 80th birthday. At that time, we started with a project to conserve 80 RET species. And we selected some 8 research scholars. And each scholar had worked on 10 species. In fact, the origin of the garden lies with that that particular project. So during that study, they have listed out many, many species. And these species now we have multiplied. And we started planting. I would say we planted over 1 million tree species so far. So the garden, the purpose of the garden, it is not merely a recreation or, you know, with a horticultural plan. You can see the garden had contributed the tree planting. And in case of wild food plants, we had the underutilized wild food. So the wild food species, in fact, if you look at the tribal community, still they have diverse species of wild food in their food basket. And this, the relevance of these wild species, if you look at our the hungry population in India, India has got the largest number of malnourished children in the world. And one side we have some 7,500 plant species recorded with edible and medicinal uses. And many species has got a high value. So how do we use this kind of diversity available in our garden or in our other gardens or in our conservation locations to address the issue? So that is what exactly when we say the nutrition garden or the garden of biofortified plants, actually the application of such kind of gardens for addressing the malnutrition. So this is where this garden has in fact collected the many such species. You can see the Dioscorea species there. And this is a wild Dioscorea. And if you look at the tribe communities like Katunaika, there at least one time food still it comes from the wild yams. You can see wild yam, not very long tuber, and this is actually very nutritious. And this kind of several wild yams, we had in fact some 30 species of wild yams. One of our researchers fellows, Dr. Balakrishnan's PhD in fact was on wild yams. So now we, this garden, our major focus is to establish a garden of all the wild edible known from the Western Ghats. And some of the, not only the forest species, but the aquatic species as well. And another focal area is the wild spice diversity. If you look at the whole Western Ghats, it's actually the Malabar coast was historically known for the wild spices. And we don't have a good qualified wild spice garden. To my knowledge, we have the sporadic pepper collections and you know the collections of turmeric and so on of the cultivars, but we don't have the collections of the wild. So this, our aim is to have this wild spice garden. We have already some species, on the left side you can see on the top. These are the numbers which are available, not in the garden, in the Western Ghats. But we have started collecting these species. And you can see the wild spice, if you look at it, I would say it is actually would be the researchers' domain. It will be a paradise for researchers. For example, the cancer research, if you look at the black pepper, Piperneys known for its action in inducing apoptosis, inhibiting proliferation, migration, and invasion of tumors. And turmeric, you know, curcumin is the much proven anti-cancerous compound. And we have several wild turmeric species. So not many wild species of spices were studied for anti-cancer properties. And we are now into developing a project. And this project is aiming to screen such kind of wild species of these five category of species. So this garden, aiming for the research projects. And also another part is the orchid area. If you see the orchid species in the this small district, we have some 165 species. And one point of time, this garden had some 80 species. I recall some 80 species available here. Now we have some 60 species of these wild orchids. So the objective is to have all the 165 species in this garden. And this is the number there, the orchid diversity of Wayanad. You can see the epiphytes, mostly are epiphytes, some 100 species. And there, some 76 species are endemic species to the peninsular India. And you can see one species, that photograph is actually that species named in my name, Dendrobium anilei. This was done by my colleague, Mr. Salim. I will be giving you a short description about who is this Salim. So this, what I'm saying to you, there are, this area is relatively still an unexplored area. There are new species still coming from relatively an explored group, person believed to be an explored group, the orchids. So you can see the kind of diversity there. For example, the genera like Bulbophyllum, we have some 12 species. And in case of Oberonia, we have some 17 species. And Dendrobium, some 14 species. So you have a good diversity in Wayanad. So this garden, when it is in full bloom, we will have a large number of collections. Our target is from this 80 to 160 species. You can see here such a beautiful orchid. So this garden, our aim is to make this Wayanad region as a repository or a conservatory of the Western Ghats orchid species. So we are not stopping with the wild species. As I started telling you, conservation is both in situ conservation and the on-farm conservation. And in this case, we are now partnering with the community. So our major partnering community is Kurchia. And this is a Kurchia farmer. He is a genome savior awardee. And he has, in fact, his own collection, some 40 different traditional rice varieties. So we don't maintain a rice field in our area, in our garden, but our rice collections are with such kind of farmers. So with our effort, we have now registered with the PPVFRA some 29 varieties. So these are designated farmers varieties, which can be used for breeding, or these are the pre-breeding varieties. And another area which we focus is actually to promote para taxonomist. So Salim, he is a para taxonomist. You can see on the right side the number of species, the number of angiosperm species. I'm telling you, even many of the scientists, they don't have this kind of number. He has so far described 8 species, and he has also described the species which are new distribution to the Kerala or South India. So we need such kind of people, and we are now offering a training program. If you visit the website of the Botanical Garden, there is a training program which we have planned for November. If corona problem is subsided, we will be definitely holding this meeting, essentially to build the capacity of our rural youth to have the capacity of describing taxa. This is the course which you can see there. It is a 10-day training program, and it is a paid course. So we will each candidate has to give 10,000, but it's for 10 days. I'm sure it will be worth taking course. And this another program which we are now thinking. We had this program in the past, the Every Child Scientist program, and this program is also now we are planning to have offering for the outside children. Earlier it was only with the children in the vicinity of the garden, but we are proposing to have the vacation program for this children scientist. They will have definitely more to see from the garden, and the virtue of this garden is actually it is close by to a forest area, so they can trek the forest and come back to the garden, and they study the garden. And this the garden program now we are proposing to establish extend to the schools with edible plants. We call it as edible school. Every child a scientist, and every school an edible school, where the school will have the edible gardens. And we also maintain a small herbarium. It is a very small herbarium. We have some 1,000 herbarium sheets now. And this herbarium, our plan is actually every garden should have a herbarium. Otherwise, the garden is not complete. The herbarium for RET plants, and the herbarium for ethnobotanically important medicinal plants, and the herbarium for wild food plants. So this we will be getting a project from the Ministry of Environment and Forest, Botanical Garden project. Last week we had an inspection from the Botanical Survey of India. Our confidence level is good to have this project. So when this project comes, definitely this herbarium component also will be growing. So all this effort, when I say the community effort, our major focus, this garden and the center, was actually to help the biodiversity management committees to prepare biodiversity registers. So the biodiversity register preparation is actually a mandatory task for every biodiversity management committee. And in India, every local body should have a biodiversity management committee. So you remember all the local bodies of India preparing biodiversity of the local committee, the local panchayats. You need capacity to build there, to identify the taxa, to prepare the relatively in a good scientific fashion the biodiversity of their region. So we helped the people of Wayanad. Biodiversity management committees, and you can see this has actually benefited the community getting their plant genome savior award. They received this award in Delhi, we have a grassroots institution exclusively for the tribal community. Most of these members have been trained for this PBR preparation. And this garden now, it is actually one of the 1775 botanical gardens of the world, recognized by the Botanical Garden Conservation International. So it is a BGCI recognized garden. That is not a simple recognition. And we also now recently got recognition for the arboretum, where, you know, the trees, the garden maintains an arboretum, and this arboretum has been recognized by the Arb Network of the world, and that level one recognition. They have a four level recognition. The fourth level is actually a big level. So our aim is to get to that fourth level recognition, for which you need really scientifically maintained garden. In the sense, you know, you need more than 500 RET tree species, not necessarily RET, but more than 500 RET tree species. We have only 100 species now. So we will be eventually making it into that level recognition. So my last part is the way forward plan. So we are, if you look at our approach, that 4C approach, built with the community centric, you know, the driver. Actually, the driving aspects of the garden is actually the community needs, the community's welfare, or the community's, you know, the empowerment. With this philosophy, we look into conservation, we look into the cultivation of the necessary species, we look into the consumption promotion, and we look into the necessary livelihood development. So if you see these parameters actually rooted in the SDGs, and SDGs now, if you see SDG 17 goals have been divided into four groups: the ecological goals, the social ecological goals, the social goals, and the driver goals. And this garden, in fact, looking into from the ecological goals, the two goals, the life on land, definitely the conservation, and the climate action in the form of mitigation. And from the social ecological goals, definitely into the hunger goal, as I said, the wild food collections and so on, and the poverty goal, plus the good health, the medicinal plant, and, you know, the green health campaign. So now in the future, we have, with the help of Denver Botanical Garden, there is a master plan has been developed. And this master plan, in fact, suggested to divide this garden into three sections. The first is the community zone. Second is the agrobiodiversity zone. Third is the RET zone. And the community zone will have where, you know, the community people can come, and, you know, there should be a kind of general visitors around the garden. And you can see, this is the, you can see on the left side top, Dr. Sharada Krishnan. She is the community program director of the Denver Botanical Gardens. So with her leadership only, we have prepared this, but 5 years have been over. We are into fundraising. And the suggestion was for a butterfly garden, because we have a small garden now, to develop into a full-fledged butterfly garden. And when it is full-bloomed, this is the view. The kind of, you know, there will be a dorm and so on. And the child garden, where, you know, the children's, every child assigned this program will be developed into the form of a children's garden. And there is a sensory garden, where, you know, we have in headquarters, we have a touch and smell garden. It is actually an extension of not only you touch and smell, you can sense, you need not touch by your senses. How do you understand the plant species? So this is a garden which we are proposing. And also, if you look at the Wayanad is actually a landslide prone area. Many landslides continuously last 2 years. So we are now into promoting these trees for restoring such degraded areas. We call it as a campaign called "Grow Our Dying Trees." Which we call it as God trees. So we have identified some 100 sacred groves to restore such species, some 100 species and 100 sacred groves. And these trees, which we have divided into four categories. One is the 25 species are critically endangered, and the endangered trees, and the vulnerable trees, and the sacred trees, 25 each. And we started this in the form of a campaign. We started identifying the sacred groves. From Wayanad, we have identified some 25 sacred groves. From Malabar region, we will be completing. In the whole Malabar region, we have more than some 4,000 sacred groves. So out of 4,000 sacred groves, we are selecting 100 sacred grove species. So saving trees, actually, the campaign is actually, when you donate, you will be saving your tax, because the MSSRF has been approved for the donor, for the tax exemption for donors, with that aspect which we are trying to mobilize. And if you look at for the campaign, we have for the garden as a whole, we have three major campaign mode. Apart from this, the bird trees, garden to the people, and people to the garden, and how the garden grows. And you can see the different elements listed out there. And the capital needs, if you look at, we are expecting some 1,200 plus some 1,900,000, some 19 crores, out of which the revenue which we think we can generate, if it is full-fledged, we should be able to generate some income. And you can see some of this campaign which we have already started. We wrote to many, many people. Unfortunately, this COVID came in. We had some green signals from some projects, but COVID blocked it. But still, our hope is not lost. We are into it. And this, you can see different donor ties. We have divided into the donor into individual donation amount into different categories, from 10,000 to 20 lakhs. If people are interested in donating, you know, even for the god trees, only 1,000 rupees. Here it is, the front of the forest, the tier 5 is 10,000. So this is the other category, the how the garden grows campaign category, the different categories. So then I'm not pleading to you to donate, but this is the slide which I prepared for the fundraising campaign. So we can, the people can donate either to the endowment funds or for some of our projects. So with this, I stop here.
Yeah. I thank Anil very much for the wonderful presentation and colorful slides, and perhaps you should come up with a very ambitious and visionary presentation next time, or maybe as part of this exercise that we are doing for this garden itself. And thank you so much, Anil.
Thank you
for your presentation.